Okay, so today we're going to talk about the chain rule, and in order to motivate the chain rule, I'm going to do a very simple-minded example. Let's look at a function f of x is equal to 2x minus 5, and g of x is equal to negative 1/3 of x plus 4. Now we know that f is a straight line with slope 2 and y-intercept negative 5. And we know that g of x is a line of slope negative 1/3 and y-intercept 4. And if we compute f of g of x, we'll find out that that's equal to 2 times the quantity negative 1/3 of x plus 4 minus 5. And so that's going to be negative 2/3 of x plus 8 minus 5, or negative 2/3 of x plus 3. The important thing is that the slope of the composition is the product of the slopes. Okay? Now, in general, we have an algebraic function y equal f of x, and we have an algebraic function y equal g of x, and we all know that slope is the analog of the derivative, or rather, the derivative is the analog of slope, and the derivative changes as you move from point to point, and we wanted to compute the derivative of f of g of x. Now, for this scenario, we think about our function y equal f of x, and we think about a point x naught on the curve. We think about a line tangent to the curve at x naught. So this is f at x naught. We think about a nearby point x naught plus h. We look at the value f at x naught plus h, and we realize that f at x naught plus h minus f at x naught is approximately equal to f prime at x naught times h. Well, it's exactly equal to f prime at x naught plus h sum plus an error function, and the error function is small in comparison with h. We can use this property to characterize the derivative, and this is the property that we're going to use in order to prove the chain rule. So let's set this up. We know that g of x naught plus h minus g at x naught will be equal to g prime at x naught times h plus an error function that depends on g at h. And we know that f at x naught plus k minus f at x naught is going to be equal to f prime at x naught times k plus an error function that depends on f and is small with respect to k. So we're going to, in fact, we want to make this not x naught, but y naught. And we're going to set y naught equal to g of x naught. And we're going to set k to be equal to g of x naught plus h minus g at x naught. And so when we take f of y naught plus k minus f at y naught, then what we're actually computing is we're computing f at g of x naught plus k minus f at g f of g of x naught plus h minus f at g of x naught. Because y naught plus k is g of x naught plus g of x naught plus h minus g of x naught. And so that simplifies down to g of x naught plus h. Now we want to compute this, but we can use the derivative approximation to compute this. This is going to be f prime at y naught times k plus epsilon of f as it depends on k. So that's going to be f prime at y naught. Now what is k? K is equal to the difference in g, so that's going to be delta g, g of x naught plus h minus g of x naught. And we have the error function that depends on k. Meanwhile, we can approximate the difference in values of g by its derivative, and that's going to be g prime at x naught times h plus epsilon of g of h, and then we have plus epsilon f at k. So this becomes f prime at g of x naught, because y naught is g of x naught, times g prime at x naught times h plus f prime at y naught times epsilon g of h plus epsilon f at k. Now we'd be done as soon as we realize that this quantity over here is small in comparison with h, because here we have f prime of g of x naught times g prime of x times our incremental quantity. So what we need to do is compare this quantity, f prime y naught epsilon g of h, epsilon f of k, and compare that with h, and we're going to do that over here. So we want to take the limit as h tends to 0 of the absolute value of f prime of g of x naught times epsilon g of h plus epsilon f of k, and we want to compare that with h, so we need to divide through by h. And we'll do that in absolute value. This will be less than or equal to the limit as h tends to 0 of f prime at g of x naught times epsilon g of h over h in absolute values. That term will go to 0, plus the limit as h tends to 0 of epsilon f of k divided through by h. And we have to show that this term goes to 0. But in order to do that, we need to write down what k is. Remember, k is the increment in g. So this is equal to 0 plus the limit as h tends to 0 of epsilon f. Well, wait a second. I can just write k here. I can put a k here. And then I can put a k here and then an h here, because I can multiply and divide through by k. And that's going to be equal to the limit as h tends to 0 of the absolute value of epsilon f of k divided through by k. And then k is g of x naught plus h minus g of x naught over h. This quantity is the derivative of g. This quantity is small in comparison to k, and so that whole quantity is 0. And what we've shown is that the difference in f of g of x, the difference in values, is approximated to a very good degree of approximation by the derivative of f at g of x naught times the derivative of g at x naught times h.